Thank you. Wonderful. My name is Mamadi. This is the True Breakfast Show. Our first discussion is about to start, and we are privileged this morning to have with us the Vice Chairman of the Congress for Democratic Change. No doubt, the biggest opposition political party of the Republic of Liberia. They are now warming up, ready for the 2014 senatorial elections. We call in this morning to talk about the process leading to the convention and, of course, other related issues. Good morning, Mr. Morlu, and welcome to the show.
Good morning, my man. It's a pleasure, and I'm excited to be your guest.
Okay, just drive us through, especially the Maryland County Wahala, that saw Mr. Buffett was emerging as your candidate.
Wow. As you are aware, Mr. Deputy, the CDC regionalized this primary is in three different regions, one of which was to take place in the southeastern region of the regional county of Maryland. On the 8th of June, the regional counties, five counties assembled in that part of Liberia to elect senatorial aspirants that would reflect the party or better party standard in the coming senatorial elections. Mm-hmm. And all four counties were successfully elected their candidates, except for Maryland. Mm. Which ended into a braha when Mr. Jimmy Anderson, or James Anderson, challenged the election result announced by the primary committee, ascending Representative Buffett Chimba as the candidate of that country. So immediately we tried to put together a committee to investigate what obtained in that electoral process on June 8th. Mm. And that committee was given a 7-day timeline to begin a conclusive investigation process.
Headed by?
With 7 men seated, headed by Councilor Simon Serena Sipa, with Madam Mona Penna Youngblood as Secretary General and others, Franklin, Mr. Franklin Wissa, etc. This gone week, the committee concluded its investigation process and submitted a report that recommended several things, one of which was that the party should be very cautious when sending individuals to represent its establishment to primaries, because these individuals will be required to exercise the most moral uprightness and political responsibility to execute the democratic process that will determine who the party puts forth in a democratic process.
That those you send to organize primaries, for that sort, should be people. Credible people.
Not just credible, but with the requisite experience and the credential to do that job.
Okay.
That was one of the recommendations. Two, the committee recommended that Honorable Buffett Chimba, who was considered reprehensible for announcing himself as winner of the election, should write an official apology and publish in full local journals, apologizing for taking upon himself the responsibility to announce himself winner.
Okay.
The third recommendation being that Mr. Anderson also should be reprimanded or should be warned and made to desist in subsequent processes from going to the papers or the press to ridicule the party and make opinion that I consider culpable when dealing with political displeasure emanated from electoral processes. And the fourth was that the committee's report submitted, there's a committee from Harper, Maryland County that conducted the process. Was thereby sustained, announcing Honorable Chimbos as the winner of that process, and that complaints that were filed by the Candidate Executive Committee challenging that report did not have no substantive legal standing or legal bearing, and was not sufficient to overturn the credibility of the result, and thereby recognizing Honorable Chimbos as the legitimate and credible winner of the process that was conducted on June 8th in the country.
What happened to those participated in the process and defended that the Buffett Chimba was in the process?
Okay, that was one. What do you mean by defended that the Buffett Chimba was?
Because the committee report said Mr. James Gray, recommended the suspension.
That was the last part of the report.
Yeah.
Recommended that Mr. Gray should be suspended for time indefinite, campaigning in the press not just campaigning, but announcing the report that emanated from that convention.
So he shouldn't when have announced the report?
The report should have been submitted to the executive, to the first steering committee, the executive committee. Mm-hmm. And if there were challenges in swinging that process, it should have been challenged through the appropriate legal democratic process. And not the one of the press and made comments that I consider recalcitrant and equally reprehensible.
Did the committee talk to Mr. Mr. Anderson?
I believe the talk to all sides because the committee was given different mandates, which included that the subpoena of witnesses or those that I thought were relevant to the investigation process, and that included Mr. Anderson, Dr. Chimbos, etc. So I cannot drive you through the workings of the committee in terms of how it concluded its report. What I can discuss is the claim of report submitted by the committee to the executive committee, which highlighted the following recommendation I've just intimated to you. Lastly, about Mr. Gray's suspension, he was not suspended because he was a participant in fraud. He was suspended
The CDC did not endorse that particular aspect of that.
The CDC endorsed all aspects of the report.
And that was not suspended.
No, I'm saying the committee's recommendation for suspension was not because he was a participant in fraud, but because of breaching the party's communication principle when he went to the papers to discuss what should have been otherwise handled by the executive committee of the party. Okay. So he did not have the authorization from the executive committee to now begin to go to the press, discuss issues surrounding that the Maryland primaries, even though he was one of the individuals appointed to conduct the primaries. But there was a report submitted to the executive committee which should have been looking to by the executive committee. So if there were misgivings or displeasure about that, the way the executive committee or the party was proceeding, there was no normal to revert to the party to legitimize that complaint.
Who chaired the process in Maryland County?
It was not Professor Bogare of the University of Liberia. He was the chairman of that committee. And I don't know who the Secretary General was, but he presided over that process. And he submitted a report signed by all committee members.
The sticker issue from Maryland has to do with the vote cast. Were there any recount of the vote?
There was no recount of the vote. I don't think there was a recount of the vote. The sticker issue was not just vote count. The issue that there was that the result was not, the elections wasn't credibly conducted in full. That is the beginning to the end. That was the complaint filed by members of the executive committee of the country. It is important to stress that a committee meeting within the 7 days scope of its operation decided that there was no merit, there was no full merit into the complaint filed by the county executive committee that was seeking to overturn the authenticity of the result that was submitted by the committee. And so its complaint was trashed, and that the result submitted by the Boca Raton committee was thereby sustained and asked the chambers as a legitimate winner of the democratic press.
Okay, I think we'll leave that. That's a decision of the party. We'll look up to that in the future. That move not to Grand Cape. I understand you have some issues that have been settled also.
There was no issue in Grand Cape. What we experienced, which is a normal democratic practice or democratic spillover when people go to the democratic processes and get defeated, is no more for disenchantment, for displeasure. Tension will be high, people feel invested into the process, people have expectations. So when they don't get voted into by delegates assembling in specific region, then there is a possibility for emotional outbursts. That's what we experienced in the Grand Cape Mon scenario when one of the participating aspirant thought he wasn't fairly treated. Then there were rules and regulations laid down for addressing of grievances, which wasn't followed, and he chose to go to the paper. So we didn't dignify that with an attempt to investigate because there was no complaint filed by the executive committee. I we would have set up similar investigative
committees. What was the contention?
I don't know the argument. Probably you can speak to him. But what I thought...
Well, obviously there may be some issues that he raised that led to the quote-unquote resignation.
Yeah, but he
resigned from...
He didn't fire... I can speak to that because I didn't receive a formal letter of resignation.
Well, how did he arrive at the decision or the knowledge that he has resigned?
He was on the radio.
So you are acting on the radio?
Excuse me?
Are you acting based on radio?
We've not acted. I'm giving information.
So you agree that he's out of the party now?
No, I didn't say he's out of the party. I said there was displeasure. There was emotional outburst. When the radio, he expressed disenchantment that he wasn't fairly treated. But in the absence of a legitimate complaint, I cannot dignify the comments of the partners who was already, because that is not the appropriate procedure for the addressing of grievances.
Okay.
If there was an official complaint, we would have documented that complaint, a set of committee meets, and then decide what to do with that complaint. But in the absence of that, we cannot make comment to his radio rants.
Okay, so for the 15 countries, you have seditions, or you're doing collaboration in some area?
Yeah, we're doing collaboration in one area, okay. That is in the Grand Cape area, where Professor Abachil is a candidate.
Okay.
The party has been discussing, he has been meeting with the party for almost 2 years now, mm-hmm. and the party thought to, in the best case scenario, endorse him as candidate for the Grenfell County Senatorial election, mm-hmm. because of his proficiency, because of his strength, because of the fact that he made there is a closer proximity of the candidate to the party in terms of interest. So there are other things I cannot say on the radio right now at this point, but I think it was the best decision rendered by the party. Because either way,
but did you have sedition applying to run?
Yeah, there was an individual that applied to contest for that county.
Okay.
And he
sedition.
Was what? Yeah, most seditions were applied to run.
No, I think somebody applied for collaboration. He asked for collaboration.
Yeah. Chie asked to collaborate with the party, and he saw the party's endorsement. The brother who applied to be a candidate in that county is a counselor. He was required, as all other aspirants are required, to proceed to the primaries in Jerome County, to participate in the process, to get endorsement by the candidate executive committee, to be voted into, which he failed to do. He did not appeal in
Jerome. He did not consummate the process.
He did not, yes. So because of that, he was definitely ruled out of the process. He was disqualified, leaving the ticket blank. And even though Professor Chi was in consultation with the party, how we have a sedition to contest, to go to the primaries, and get the endorsement of the candidate, I mean, of the electorate gathering in Harper County to elect the candidate for Grand Cru. We would have preferred that person above an independent candidacy.
Unfortunately, Grand Cru is supposed to be one of your strongholds.
It is our stronghold.
Yeah, to have only one person, one sedition, express an interest. What does that speak to for you?
Basel and Monserrat is our stronghold too. We got only one person.
Your most competent and most qualified
person. That's our silo, it's a stronghold likewise. Mm-hmm. We got only one person. I think the idea behind one person candidacies in the pitches was derived by candidate executive committees to minimize the possibility of a process that will be flooded with individuals without the requisite political credential to contest. So what it did was, in my view, was they saw the best cream de la cream of the partisans in the counties, and tried to minimize, waste of time, but manage time, resources, manage money, manage energy by going to these processes.
So they
did that, and so we had no option to. We couldn't coerce them to bring 2-3 persons into the process, okay. where they felt this person was would best reflect the credentials of the party. Who better reflect the party standard in a specific process. So it was more or less a decision of the assembly delegates and not the executive committee most around the country.
Mayor Tia, you're one of your big names of 2005 and of course 2011, and has resigned.
Resigned?
Yeah, from the CDC. So is that correct?
When did he resign?
He has resigned last 2 weeks ago.
Well, as far as we're concerned, Mr. TJ was suspended for more than 2 years, and he did not come back to take advantage of the parties.
Yeah, well, suspension does not mean he's not a member.
Well, if he resigned, I think it's a good thing for the party for Mr. Tigger to resign.
Tell me, what makes that a good thing?
Because in the last 3 years or so since the re-election of President Sirleaf, he has done little to reflect the ideological premise of the party to the larger public. He has become what I consider an internal virus of the party, spreading information and activities against the party that tend to run detrimentally to the interests of the institution in Sino County.
Example?
He goes to places in Sino County and speak anti-CDC messages. He castigates our standard bearer. And his own record in the Ghana, which I don't want to draft too deeply into, about corruption, alleged corruption activities, stemming power to people, public interest in Sangro County.
Was he
bringing up a division? Bringing up a division. You don't get convicted by everything before they can be a substantive argument.
Some of those then working in the government.
I just say allege.
Okay.
Allege.
Yeah. So based upon that allegation.
No, not those. Not that allegation.
Okay.
I'm saying every individual politician within the confines of our party is required to at all times reflect the philosophical credibility of the CDC to the larger public, to larger constituencies. For Mr. Chiaji, for instance, when he was appointed as superintendent for Sangro County, there was no consultation done with the party in regards to how you proceed, why you're taking the job, as for how the party interest being maximized, and signing the job, etc. So that's what we're discussing TRG. Now,
besides TRG as a standard,
but all partisans, but you
so all partisans that were appointed, did they consult the party?
Which one of them?
All CDCs who were appointed in the government, for example, who hired a secretary general.
Of course, you had to consult the party. There's nothing the secretary general did without.
At the time, he did consultation.
He did, and before he resigned his job, he also consulted the party at the highest level. So that's what prudent
so partisans. So you're not troubled by and Mr. TRG's resignation at all.
But if it is a phrase to use, I think Mr. TRG's presence was more of an embarrassment to the party. He was become an excess baggage. And remember now, there is a politics introduced in the country that is dividing the country. Remember, Sino country had to have the independence celebration postponed and maybe taken out of the country, according to government sources for barrier condition. Well, we know this not because of barrier condition, because of the tribalizing of our politics in Sino that has divided the people so acutely. I was in Sino, I've been in Sino twice in the last 6 months. The country is acutely divided in the middle because of the politics introduced by Mr. Chege, which is going to decimate the political level we have in Sino. One say we, the Liberian people in Sino. And no solution want to do that. We don't divide communities, we don't divide institutions. That is directly contrary to the ideological, philosophical belief of the CDC. To go to Sino because you want to become senator, you bring about for the 8 sessions against the, I call it, the Sabo people constituting 6 sessions, only because you want to maximize political leverage. I think that is reprehensible, it is culpable, and it should be condemned in the highest possible term. And so when people trade that trajectory, it is incumbent upon us to distance ourselves from that kind of individual, because you're not only trading a dangerous political paradigm, but you are seeking to bring up a division that is very dangerous, that will lead to crisis. And we're still opposed to that. So when that kind of individual resigns from your party, you've got to celebrate, because he was a 360 degrees away from our party's philosophical belief. Tribalizing politics inside your country, for the extension, dividing the youth, sowing seed of discord. That's not the kind of solution we want to have in our midst.
Is the CDC also considering supporting Grand Bassa?
Then we wouldn't have put up a candidate in Grand Bassa. We have a candidate, we have no intent to support an individual who is already linked to the unit of the party. We would not have done that. We've never
collaborated with the unit of the
party.
He's up to the support
of special political interest.
He's up to the support of all political parties, not only the unit of the party.
Yeah, but we answer no to that question when we conducted a primary in Grand Bassa County that elected Solomon Murray as our candidate for Grand Bassa. So it definitely speaks to the fact that we have no intent. It's not even contemplated that we're going to be supporting, especially somebody who has not been endorsed by the ruling party. There's no specific interest of divergence between the CDC and the party. It has never been and will never be. So once it's the interest of the United Party, that's the point of break away from the CDC. We don't want to support
the stability. Let me tell you the other names, sir, in the other counties.
Okay, we have Professor Dona Kamara from Bombay County, a former employee of African Development Bank, university professor at a graduate, undergraduate level, former employee of the National Public Authority, the Finance Minister, etc. He's standing up for Bombay County. He's young, he's popular, he's energetic, he's party driven, he's disciplined. As for Bombay County. Then we have, of course, Professor Dow Sonny. Professor Sonny stands as a candidate for Magibi County. I think he has 30 years working experience at the University of Liberia in the teaching profession. Then he's vice president of the University of Liberia, etc., etc. He's a very strong person, energetic. He's sweet, people supporting the country. He's respected, credible. If it's a word to use, uncorrupt, untouched corrupt. And he's one of our finest in the race for the Senate, and we believe that he's going to be in the Senate with Ambassador Weah come 2015. Then we also have on our list of candidates Mr. Augustus Trinidad Flomo from Bourbon County. He has a master's degree. He is from the lowest end of society, a real downtrodden member of our social class. In fact, his father is from the disabled community. You know, also we are proud of him. He's strong. He formerly worked at the Cornell University as an accountant. he's managed different international programs. He's going to be standing up in the contest. The last time he contested in 2011, I think he accumulated around 40,000 or so votes. Mm-hmm. His statistics can prove me right. So he's going to be standing in Bonn County to be the standard of the party.
Bonn County.
Then we believe, yeah, in Bonn, we believe he's going to inevitably, you know, emerge as winner. Then we have Nathaniel Fallon McGill. He's our Secretary General, former student activist on the University of Liberia, degree in economics, BS in economics, former assistant minister at the Ministry of Internal Affairs. As I said, assistant secretary general of CDC, he's going to be standing up in Bakolo. He is strong, I can say that for fight. All the areas we've been to in Bakolo, people we've interacted with, his connection to the grassroots is so strong that we have no doubt that Mr. McGill will emerge winner in the October elections.
Nima
County. Nima, we have Bessie, Councillor Yami Kwekwe Bessie. Councillor Bessie, as stated already in the intro, is a councillor of law. He's a councillor of law. He is, I aware his father was also in that profession. Before his deceased, and he was normally referred to as a poor man lawyer.
You think so? It is feed the incumbent, Senator Prince Johnson?
I have no doubt. Oh. I have no doubt. The level of enthusiasm, the level of excitement he brings to the political debate in Nimba County, I have no doubt that a person like Yami Kogwegbesi, the voice of the poor in Nimba, the advocate of the poor in the legal courtroom, is going to chart the course of victory in Nimba come October election. We have no doubt. Ultimately, he's going to be measured winner. Richmond Nangwe Tobi is for Sino. Okay, he's an engineer with a master's degree. He's a chief operating officer. Simba Technology, terminal manager, Eagle, Wellington, etc. etc.
And these are members of the party.
These are all the same. There's not a single person who won primary who is not a member of the CDC.
You're supporting.
We collaborated in one instance, okay, in Grand Cru
County. Grand Cru
County. That's the only place we've collaborated. Every other county where we presented candidates, those individuals are bona fide members of the CDC, bona fide cadre members of the party who have proven their loyalty to the party at all levels. Even those who are new members have been tested and proven to be credibly established within the ranks of the party's ideological belief, and we believe that they will stand for the party in the 2015 Senate of the Republic. So for River Sales, we have Anthony Tepler, Pamela Reeves. Of course, she's a lawyer and former president of the Female Association of Liberia. I think you know she's a very popular person, not just in Monrovia, but in River Sales as well. And we believe she will be in the party standard in that part of Liberia, and she's going to do all that she can to bring about a victory within and reflect the grassroots interest that is supposed to be detected in the House of Senate after the October elections. For River G, we have Alexander P.B. Yaya. He's an accountant, also a graduate. Although he was at one time the Vodana superintendent in the county, and he's connected. The region he hailed from is the most populous region in River G. He's a young person who has done a lot of enterprising work in the county, and we have no doubt that Mr. Yaya is also going to be standing up to put up a very strong challenge in the kind of and produce victory, the kind of victory that we need. Then we come to Monserrat County, as expected, in Buffalo, George Manuel. Mm-hmm. As you know, he has basketed a master's degree. He is a servant of the poor, respected by the graduate community, not just in Monserrat, all over Liberia. And he's seen as the inspiration in the Senate. He is the president who will be the catalyst of change in the Senate in 2015. And no doubt this election in 2014 in October is already a foregone conclusion. But even at that, there's going to be a vigorous campaign this process in this county that will maximize the voting and ensure that we go beyond landslide. So we're settling for a coin war that is more than landslide. So is it, Mama, is there something beyond landslide?
Nobody's
tsunami. Dieter Bofa Chumbot is on the ticket from Maryland County. He got a terrible degree in law enforcement. As you know, he's an advocate of the poor. He always stands up for the people, an intellectual, fire-burning intellectual that is not afraid to speak his mind, even within the confines of the party. And that's the kind of person we need for the Senate.
Okay.
Despite the fact that he is a representative in Plibo, but we believe that he served the people better as senator of Maryland County when he's elected in the October electoral process. So that's Maryland. Then we come to Lofa County is Mr. Glakpai Wizi Kotima, whose declaration was made with dismissal from the president's office. That is obvious, because this is the man that once served as the engine.
Who entry into the CDC gave him a ticket for the senatorial election?
Excuse me?
Whose entry into the CDC gave him a ticket to the senatorial election?
No, that's not what I was going to say. I was going to say this is the man that once served. It does open them as a deputy.
So that's a fact.
That's not what gave him ticket.
Okay.
What gave him ticket was a participating in the primaries in Bonkanda, and he won that primary.
Okay.
So that decision was exclusively that of the people of Lofa County.
Did he join the party prior to his dismissal, or did he join?
No, the day he was joining the party at the headquarters when his dismissal letter was being prepared. Maybe by Jeremy. So as you were saying, I hereby join the CDC. They were tapping a letter of dismiss. So you know. So but he and you can understand why they were having to dismiss Mr. Kotime. Because Kotime at one time was the chairman of a United Party in Lofa. He served in that capacity up to 2011 elections, won elections for them in Lofa. How that election was won, I don't know. But at least he was the chairman of the party won elections in Lofa County. And when that person is coming to a party that is anticipated or expected to be an inevitable winner of the coming Democratic Electoral Party in 2017, then you understand why there's so much anxiety about.
Did he jump because of the ideology or because of the Congress?
How will he jump because he wants to run? Mr.
This is my former chairman of the ruling party.
Yeah, that question should be reserved for him, but I can speak to what I know. During his declaration, he was very clear that he was enthusiastic about our party's platform, our ideology, and the fact that Madam Shamik was enthusiastic about our party's platform. His only misgiving was whether the CDC was up to the task to implement that platform.
When did
and
the
point, I can't speak for Mr. Quarterman. I'm speaking for the CDC.
So what am I saying?
That is personal.
You know,
I'm trying to interpret
okay.
what I thought was a basis that inspired his decision to join the CDC.
Okay.
I'm not speaking for him because I was there.
Do you
I
believe
received
him?
I believe in 100%.
What was the first time you issued a manifesto?
Who?
CDC.
First time?
2004. So he did not see your manifesto as a good manifesto?
I just said.
What about the question?
I understand the manifesto. He did not see it as good until when he wanted to become senator.
Okay.
That's the answer to the question.
Yeah.
But here's my answer. I just said to you that the man claimed he has always respected and believed in the manifesto, the philosophy, the ideology of the CDC. His problem has been whether the party was up to the task to implement what was ingrained in his manifesto and his philosophical belief. At the point of his declaration, he came up to the conclusion now,
yeah.
especially now that in his last days of the government's performance, when Madam Sali has proven to be a failed president in the affairs of statescraft, he believed the party has proven to him that it is mature, is ready, is prepared to take on the matter of maturity and implement those issues in his manifesto.
You believe him?
So it's not, I do believe him, but I have no doubt that he proved me otherwise. I really believe it.
But when he said the party was not mature, at the time.
When did he say that?
No, he just said, at the time he did not believe that the party had the ability to interpret the manifesto.
Yeah.
He said that. This is why he did not jump.
To implement. So he has been observing the party
reason he did not jump.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you see that as a kind of quote-unquote
insult? You want me to speak as a member of the party?
Because if you
and
told
I don't want to
take up on myself. Let me push you, the only one. If you told me that, you know, last year I've told you blah, 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 we're not qualified, we're not a thing. What difference did he see?
Well, one thing I want to know, Mr. Deputy, is we've been existing for around 10 years now.
Mm-hmm.
A lot has happened.
There's an improvement.
Thank you. And those improvements may have inspired his resolve to join the party. Because, and I agree with him. There were a lot of doubts when this party emerged as a political institution.
Okay.
And those doubts were no more political misgiving.
You know what I mean?
Whether can people really deliver? But after 10 years of performance, A lot of people all who those, have not believed that CDC is crossing, up with task.
All those who are crossing carpet, it's not on ideological principle.
Yeah,
that's
your opinion. Yeah.
It just centered around greed, centered around convenience.
But normally you are a journalist. You've opinion leading.
But I'm telling you now, no.
You're opinion leading this conversation.
Say anyone want to say.
No, my
No, my type of journalism, perhaps, is the one that you used to know. I have an opinion, I express it. All those who are cross-cabinet from one party to the other, it's not bottom of ideology.
Okay.
He's just finding a convenient route to realize the
idea. Let me take your position.
I'm not responding. We'll have to go to
Let me take your seat for a while. 1997. I'm the presenter, you are now the guest. 1997. But I'm certainly joined the ranks of the other party.
Yeah.
To contend on his ticket as standard bearer. Was that out of greed? Or
just tell me, your position on that.
No, I'm the presenter now, you are the guest.
Did I ask you? Did you ask me?
Yeah, but I'm the presenter.
No, right?
You are agreed to shift position.
Mr. Morlu, we're talking about parties membership, and a lot of persons have left and come into the CDC. And talk about the membership of a presidential hopeful Benoni Urey. What is his current status in the CDC?
Why are you bringing Urey to be all over?
No, I don't know, because there was some controversies surrounding.
Is he still a member of the CDC or an affiliate?
Well, you have to answer that question. We still consider him.
No, but you have the record of your
That's what I'm saying.
How does your record reflect?
It reflects a member that has been won. Has been warned to desist from making political moves.
A member that has been warned.
Yeah, okay. Reflect a member.
So that is current status.
The history of a member that. Yeah, he's a member.
Okay.
Member.
That was interesting.
Yeah, no, he's a member.
Okay, no problem.
But before you go to the line, remember his spokesman said 3 weeks ago that he was a sympathizer of the CDC.
He was not a member.
Mr. Lamar.
Okay.
And Mr. Urey have got to clarify that. Because that man is supposed to, either he comes up in public and distance himself from that statement, or he affirmed that statement with a yes.
Well, as far as you're concerned, he's
a member. Okay. Now, I've been cautioned to be careful how he trades political move.
No, but I will take 3 calls, so we'll do the same 0777-469794. So, no problem.
0777-469793 is the line to call.
Go ahead, my brother. Yeah, you're live, my brother. Go ahead.
Okay, so I'm going to continue my for the unity party is going to the speaker or the satisfaction that is already installed and will come in between me and the
person. Okay. Thank you. Left the party. It's not very, it's not official. It's not official that I'm saying that Kupi has left the party. Okay. Okay. Thank you, my brother. We don't have much time, so let's take this on the call. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, you're live.
Information that is part of your party.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, my brother. Good morning. The final call. Good morning. Good morning. Thank you, William Kokoro. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
It's actually called a light to speak to. I think the caller spoke my mind and sort of was a reaffirmation of what I already stated about the Urey scenario. We cannot hold Mr. Urey responsible for comments made by Mr. Lomage, except within the confines of being a spokesman for the Urey campaign. Mm-hmm. Now, the fact that there's even a spokesman for a friend of Urey, that is a non-member of the CDC, speak to the fact that Mr. Urey is already operating outside the confines of the CDC's constitutional responsibility.
Okay.
That is leading what we consider extracurricular activity contrary to our party's existing ideological premises. So what he need to do as a member of the party, now our record indicates that Mr. Urey is a member of the party, he has not resigned.
Well, he's been warned.
We warned him because he was penetrating the different countries, spreading a strange ideology that was contrary to the belief of the CDC. And so we told him that was not the best way to proceed. Once you were a party member, he must remain within the confines of party procedures and party operational mechanisms. And now that his spokesperson has come up in public to state that we were spreading misinformation about his membership to the party, it is now keeping on Mr. Urey to, within a 7 days period, come up to a disclaimer.
Seven days now. And that's the official position of the party.
I'm a party official, I'm telling you. In my capacity as the vice chair, in my capacity as the one who managed records, we gave him at least 7 days, which is reasonable enough, a 7 day period to come up in public to disclaim what his spokesperson has said, that he is not a member of the party, to disclaim or affirm that position. Now, if he affirms that position, then we'll take it to me that he has resigned from the party officially.
What if he fails?
If he fails, then the party will meet and decide what to do next. But he means to make it very clear.
Civil relationship with him if he fails to do what you said?
No, it could also mean we have to maximize effort to get to him. Okay. It could be out of the country. There could be other factors. He may not be listening to this program. His partner, he may not even hear what I'm saying. Okay. So when the 7 days, we always do that. When we cautiously warn him, we write an official letter of warning that you cannot you cannot go this direction because of ABC in the party's constitution. So we hope that Mr. Urey will take due notice and do the right thing. Because what Mr. Lomage said is culpable. He has indicted his membership to the party.
Wonderful, Mr. Mulbah Morlu. Thank you very much for always being present to talk about the Congress of Democratic Change. We appreciate your time with us this morning. And we are taking a break on this first segment of our show. My name is Mamadi, along with Solomon Webb. We'll be right back after this break.